for slide show, sir.
Okay. 1 minute, 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, sir. Is it clear now?
Ah, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Next slide. So good evening, students. Today we are going to enter into the topic of soil physics. Earlier we have seen soil pedology. Now we are going to see soil physics. Our topic is soil, air, and aeration, and measurement and management. Next slide, sir. So soil, yeah, coming to the soil, yeah, intermediation of atmosphere, yeah, atmosphere, yeah, only, and it is in constant motion from the soil pore, atmosphere, as well as from the atmosphere pore space. Then what means of soil aeration? Today, it is, if you, soil aeration.
Magesh, your voice is not clear. Please, I think, check your microphone or something. Just a minute, students. I will join. Think two new students, Sivakshi Sharma and Subhra Rajput. I didn't say this students is a new admission. Okay, students, please wait. So I will connect.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, one minute. Okay, I'm starting.
Is it audible, sir?
Yeah, I can start 1 minute. I'll share the screen. Yeah, you can start.
Okay.
So coming to the soil aeration definition, air in the soil and like your oxygen, carbon dioxide. So soil air, it is like atmospheric air, but when we speak about the soil aeration, it is not only the soil air, it is the component, some of the components of soil air, like your oxygen and carbon dioxide has been used. So these terms, the circulation and renewal, these are two important terminologies. Soil aeration is essential for respiration and survival of soil organisms and plant roots. Why the soil aeration is important? Without the soil aeration, the plants can't respire, roots can also can't respire, and microorganisms in the soil will need oxygen to respiration. So for all this things, for respiration, soil aeration is important. Next slide. Combustion. So soil air contains gases like nitrogen, oxygen, carbon dioxide, water vapors. However, the composition of soil air is different from atmosphere. In which case it is different means soil air contains more carbon dioxide and less oxygen. Why soil air containing more carbon dioxide means there is more microorganism activity, so it contains more carbon dioxide. So more oxygen will be used by the microorganism, and microorganisms tend to release more carbon dioxide when we compare to the atmospheric air. It is water vapor than atmospheric air. The nitrogen content of the soil air, it is nitrogen content of soil air is almost equal to the atmospheric air. Next slide. So this is the composition. You can see here, the soil air contains nitrogen around 79.2%, while the atmospheric air it is 79%. Changes in oxygen dioxide. Carbon dioxide content is more in soil air. It contains about 0.35, whereas your atmospheric air contains only 0.03%. And in case of your oxygen, it is more in atmospheric air, 1%. Whereas in case of your soil air, it is low, it is 20%. So this is a major difference. This slide is very important. Next slide. Coming to the mechanism, there are usually two mechanisms in which the soil aeration can be exchanged from atmosphere to soil. One is through gas convection. In other terminology, it is like mass flow. That is a bulk movement of air. The gas molecule of interest are carried in or out and through the soil by bulk air flow. It is like a bulk air flow. Then the next one is your diffusion. It is the movement of air or molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration. There is some difference between osmosis and diffusion. You can hear the term osmosis. Whenever the movement is from higher concentration to lower concentration through a semipermeable membrane, we can call it as an osmosis. Whenever the movement is from higher concentration to lower concentration, not through a semipermeable membrane, then we can call it as a diffusion. So the difference between osmosis and diffusion is the semipermeable membrane. So mostly the air highly exchanged through this diffusion process. Whereas in case of your water, it is mainly exchanged through your mass flow. So most of the gas molecules is highly exchanged through this diffusion process. Next slide. So there is one law. When we speak about diffusion, this is a very, very important law. This law has been given by Fick. So it has been renamed as Fick's law of diffusion. he stated that the rate of diffusion of a solute in any direction is proportional to the concentration gradient of the solute in that direction. If you consider an particle that has been moving, if you consider a solute that has been moving in a direction, it is directly proportional to the distance, and it is directly proportional to the concentration gradient. We can clearly see in the next slide, sir. So it states that the flux, that is the change, is directly proportional to the concentration gradient. You can see here the equation, that is J is equal to minus D into dC by dx. Here the dC denotes the change in the concentration of the materials, and dx denotes the change in the distance, and your D denotes the diffusion coefficient. So the molecule of the movement of a random molecule in any direction is directly proportional to the concentration gradient of that molecule in that particular direction. Here you can see the negative sign that indicates a decrease in the concentration of a molecule, because sometimes a molecule may be moving from higher to lower concentration. Sometimes it has some negative sign. So we are putting some negative sign. But the flux, that is a change, the change is in positive quantity. So this is a fixed law of diffusion. That is a change in the movement of a molecule is directly proportional to the concentration gradient of that molecule. Next slide. So coming to the importance, why the soil aeration is very important? Because it helps in plant and root growth. So it is an important factor in normal growth of the plants. Suppose consider the supply of oxygen to roots in adequate quantities and the removal of carbon dioxide from soil atmosphere are very essential, then only a plant can be grown healthily. So when the supply of oxygen is inadequate, you can consider a situation whereas the oxygen is limited for the plant. The plant growth either retards or ceases completely. It is mainly due to the more accumulation of carbon dioxide. If the carbon dioxide accumulation is more, it will hamper the growth of the plant roots. And the abnormal effect of insufficient aeration results in the root. Mostly, if you see the root crops, if it is not having good aeration, it will develop some abnormal root growth. So this abnormally shaped roots of these plants are common on the compact as well as poorly aerated soils. The penetration and development of roots are poor. Such undeveloped root system cannot absorb sufficient moisture and nutrients from the soil. To take a root, if a root growth is proper only means it can absorb moisture and nutrients from the soil. If there is no abnormal or a poor root growth, it cannot absorb the moisture or nutrients from the soil, thereby affects the plant growth. Next slide, sir. So coming to the next importance of soil aeration, it's a microorganism population and activity. In a soil, if we take, there are some microorganisms. Microorganisms are capable of decomposing the organic matter, thereby releasing the nutrients to the plant growth, for the plant growth. So this microorganism activity will get affected if the soil is having less oxygen or no oxygen. The microorganism living in the soil also require oxygen for respiratory metabolism. Some of the important microbial activities, just decomposition of organic matter, nitrification, sulfur oxidation, depends upon oxygen presence. Some of the important process by through the soil so that the plants can be absorbed for its growth. So the diffusion of air in soil slows down. So the microorganism population is also drastically affected by this poor aeration. Next slide. So coming to the next one, if there is a poor aeration, it will result in the formation of some toxic material. If you take the poor aeration, it results in development of toxin and other injurious substances such as your ferrous oxide and hydrogen sulfide gas. That is mainly due to the reduction of sulfur to hydrogen sulfate in this soil. So it will result in formation of some toxic material in the soil. Then fourthly, it will affect the water and nutrient absorption. As I already told, the root of the plant will be affected. So the abnormal root growth will again affect the water and nutrient uptake of the plant. Then development of some of the plant diseases. So insufficient aeration of the soil also leads to the development of some of the diseases like wilt of gram, dieback of citrus and peach. These are the, some of the common diseases. These are mainly developed due to lack of aeration in plants. So wilt of gram, dieback of citrus and peach. Next slide. So methods of characterizing soil aeration. It is just how we can measure the soil aeration. So characterization of soil aeration, either its composition or its movement, is very vital for using the soil as a medium for plant growth. Normally, they are characterized by 6 ways, but the most important thing is the measurement of ODR, that is your oxygen diffusion rate using platinum electrode method, and the measurement of redox potential. These two things are generally used to characterize your soil aeration. Other methods include measuring the total porosity and aeration porosity. Just measuring the pore space between occupied by air and water. In soil, generally, the 25% of pore space is occupied by air and 25% by water. So by measuring the porosity, air-filled porosity, just by knowing how much pores has been occupied by air, it's one of the way to characterize soil aeration. Another one is measurement of air permeability by mass flow method. It is like a bulk flow. We are measuring the air permeability. It may be through steady state or a falling pressure method. And third one is the measurement of gaseous composition. What are the gases that has been present in the soil, like nitrogen, oxygen, and carbon dioxide, how much it is present. Just measuring that, it is a measurement of gaseous composition. And fourth one is the measurement of gaseous diffusion. It is measuring the gas diffusion rate of that particular molecule. And measurement of oxygen diffusion rate, the platinum electrode method, and measurement of redox potential method. This is going to see in detail because these two things are very important. Next slide. Right. Coming to this oxygen diffusion rate, shortly known as ODR. Remember, it is oxygen diffusion rate, not oxygen diffusion ratio. Because in most of the exams, they will expand. You have a question like expand ODR. So we need to write oxygen diffusion rate. It is not oxygen diffusion ratio. You need to be clear in that aspect. So coming to the principle, when a certain electric potential is applied between a reference electrode and platinum electrode inserted in the soil, then oxygen tends to get reduced at the platinum surface, resulting in current flow between the electrodes. Remember, in this oxygen diffusion rate, you will have two different electrodes. One is your reference electrode, another one is the platinum electrode. It is same like a pH electrode method. You will have a reference and a platinum. This platinum electrode will reduce your oxygen. Whenever it gets some oxygen, it will reduce the oxygen so that we can, so that some current has been produced that has been related to the amount of oxygen it can present in the particular soil. So that thereby measuring the amount of oxygen that is present in the particular soil. So the current is proportional to the rate of oxygen reduction. That is, the current is governed by the rate of diffusion of oxygen to the electrode. So we are having two electrodes, platinum electrode and reference electrode. This reference electrode will have given a standard potential. This platinum electrode will tend to reduce your oxygen. So that is, there will be change in the potential. So this change in potential is directly proportional to the amount of oxygen that is present in the soil. So this is the principle of the oxygen diffusion rate. Next slide, sir. So coming to this working, how it works. To characterize a diffusion, we have a small platinum wire microelectrode. It is in the soil mainly to electrically reduce oxygen. This platinum electrode simulates like a respiring route, to which it will go up, it will allow oxygen to diffuse and through the air as well as the water filled pores and through the water film surrounding the route. This microelectrode measures the effect of restriction along this pathway on the supply to the electrode surface. What this micro platinum electrode will do? It will simulate. Simulate means it will like this route which allows water and oxygen to pass through itself. Similarly, this platinum electrode will allow oxygen and water to pass through it. So it will find how much of restriction is for the, is there is for the oxygen to pass through the electrode. That will be mention it as an amount of oxygen that has been present in the particular soil. Next slide, sir. So the current measure through an electrode tip of that has been supplied at a steady potential, that is your reference electrode, is related to the steady state reduction of oxygen. So there is some potential mainly due to the reduction of this oxygen. That is proportional to the amount of oxygen present in the soil. So this techniques become known as the soil ODR measurement, that is your oxygen diffusion rate. And coming to the optimum ODR, if you take for plant growth, the optimum ODR must be 20 × 10⁻¹ gram per centimeter square per meter. So the optimum ODR plant growth is being affected. So if you are measuring the ODR through this microplatinum electrode, the soil must have an 20 × 10⁻¹ gram per centimeter square per minute or above ODR, or else the plant growth has been affected. Plant growth because of lack of aeration. So you need to know this, the optimum ODR value as well as the unit of ODR. Unit of ODR is gram per centimeter square per minute, and the optimum ODR is 20 × 10⁻¹. In recently now, since the platinum electrode lose their sensitivity, this platinum electrode, when we are using for a long period of time, it will tend to reduce its sensitivity. So in that case, we can go for this wax impregnated graphite electrodes. Shortly, they are calling this WIGE, WIGE, wax impregnated graphite electrodes. They are having greater current efficiencies and wider current plateau than your platinum electrodes. It can withstand for a longer period of time in compared to your platinum electrode. Some of the factors that are affecting this oxygen diffusion rate are your water content and electrode contact in the soil and presence of your reducible compounds. These are some of the factors that will affect your oxygen diffusion rate when we are measuring. Next slide, sir. Then the second one is your redox potential. This is very, very important. In most of the exams, most of the bank exams as well as some of the JRF, SRF exams, there is compulsorily one question on this aspect. So you need to be clear on this aspect. So this redox potential, it is one of the way to characterize in soil aeration. It is also called as an oxidation reduction potential. So it is a quantitative measure of the tendency of this given system to oxidize or reduce some of the substances. So oxidation and reduction always occur together. Whenever an oxidation reaction is happening, simultaneously reduction reaction also occur. So any chemical change which influence exchange of electrons will also influence redox potential. This oxidation and reduction, it all depend upon the electrons, exchange of electrons. So whatever exchange has been happening, it will affect this oxidation and reduction. Next slide. So before going into the topic, we can have some idea about oxidation and reduction. So oxidation is nothing but loss of electrons. You can see here, that is Fe plus 2 to Fe plus 3. Fe plus 2 is your ferrous and Fe plus 3 is your ferric. So whenever a compound is losing electron, it is said to be oxidized. Next one, sir. So here, gain of electrons, reduction is. So whenever a compound is gaining electrons, it is said to be reduced. That is ferric to ferrous. So oxidation is loss of electrons and reduction is gain of electrons. So it will confuse you. So we can remember in a simple way, oil, O-I-L. So oxidation is loss of electrons. Reduction, R-I-G, rig. Reduction is gain of electrons. Oil, rig. So if you remember in this way, it will not confuse you. So oxidation is loss of electrons and reduction is gain of electrons. Whenever a substance gets oxidized, it is losing some electrons. And whenever a substance is said to be reduced, it is gaining electrons. So next slide. So So coming to the electron donors and acceptors. So this there is some gain of electrons and there is some loss of electrons, I told you. So what are the things that are present in the soil will donate electrons, and what are the things that are present in the soil will accept electrons. There are some electron donors and electron acceptors in soil. So coming to the common electron donors, if you take your organic matter, your ammonium, your sulfur and iron, they are common electron donors in the soil. And coming to the common electron acceptors like your oxygen, nitrate, your ferric, your sulfate and your manganese, all these are common electron acceptors. The source of electrons for biological reduction is your organic matter. Next slide, sir. So coming to this redox potential, when a soil is said to be under submerged condition, the reduction of soil takes place, and the reduced soil contains reduced counterparts like your nitrate, sulfate, manganese, iron and carbon dioxide. Usually if you take your redox potential, it is measured in millivolts. The reduction of different soil components takes place in a sequential form. It will follow some sequence like that. Nitrates are tend to be reduced first, followed by your manganese and so on. Sir, please press the next button. Yeah, this sequence it will follow. So here your O denotes your oxygen. So this microorganism will have preference for oxygen. If oxygen is not there, if there is lack of aeration, then the microorganism will take electron from your nitrogen. It will prefer nitrogen or manganese. If nitrogen is present, it will take electron from nitrogen. Once it take electron from nitrogen, it will become reduced. As we already seen, microorganism is gaining electron from nitrogen. So it will tend to reduce and manganese, and then it will attack iron, then sulfur and carbon dioxide. So the preference is first to nitrogen or manganese, then to iron, then to sulfur, and then to your carbon dioxide. So this sequence it will follow. So this will resulted in reduction of some of the compounds, and there is some the redox potential will be depending upon the amount the nutrients that has been present in the soil. So it may be in higher or in a lower range. If there is nitrogen or manganese, it may be higher. If it is sulfur or carbon dioxide, means it is lower. That means if it is sulfur, means the microorganisms utilize nitrogen, manganese and iron, then it is moving to sulfur. Likewise, the redox potential will tend to vary depending upon the condition and also the microorganism that has been present in the soil. Next slide, sir. So this is your redox ladder. As I already mentioned, the microorganism will have preference for your oxygen first. So they are calling it as an oxic. And they will have preference for your nitrate. So they are calling it as a post-oxic, that is your nitrate and manganese. And they will have preference for iron and then sulfur and carbon dioxide and finally water. So they are giving different names for that. For oxygen, they are giving aerobes. For nitrate, dinitrophiles. For manganese oxide, they are giving the name manganese reducers. For iron hydroxide, they are giving us an iron reducers. And similarly for sulfate reducers. And CO2, they are giving a name as methanogens. Next slide, sir. Yes, this slide is very important. This range, that redox potential value, that is your millivolts value, it has been frequently asked in your examinations. So coming to the first part, that is your oxygen is converting to water. If you see the redox potential value, it is 380 to 320. As I already mentioned, this oxygen will have first preference for microorganism. The redox potential value is higher. If there is no oxygen, then they will take the electron from your nutrients. So the first nutrients they will attack is your nitrate. So nitrate will be reduced to your elemental nitrogen. And the redox potential value is around 280 to 220. And similarly, the Mn4+, it is your manganese, will be reduced to manganic. That is Mn2+ is your manganic. So that the microorganism will have same preference for nitrogen as well as manganese. So they can attack either nitrogen or manganese. Then coming to the iron, this Fe3+ is your ferric. It has been reduced to your ferrous Fe2+. So the redox potential value is 180 to 150. And if it goes after iron, will have negative redox potential value. If you take sulfur, that is sulfate is reduced to sulfide, that is your hydrogen sulfide, the redox potential value is -122, -180. And carbon dioxide is reduced to methane, the redox potential value is -200 to -280. And water vapor or some of the gases, it's been reduced to -200 to -420. So this is the most important table. You can get some questions in this aspect. Next slide, sir. So these are the element, and whenever it is an oxidized form and whenever it is in reduced form. So oxygen is the element, it will be present as an oxygen gas whenever in oxidized condition. Reduced, it is water, it's H2O. And nitrogen, it is present as nitrate ion. Under reduced condition, it will become elemental nitrogen, that is your nitrogen gas. And manganese will be present as a manganous ion. And at reduced form, it will be manganic ion. And iron is ferrous and it will be reduced to ferric. And sulfur is sulfate, it has been reduced to hydrogen sulfide. And similarly, your carbon, that is present as carbon dioxide, is reduced to methane. Next slide. So this measurement of redox potential, how we can measure this redox potential? It is also measured with a platinum electrode method, the similar way. There will be two electrodes, like your reference and platinum electrode method. And this platinum electrode method will electrically reduce oxygen whenever we kept in the soil. And there is some difference in some electric potential. And by that, we can know how much oxygen is present in the soil. And recently, they have in previous cases they will be immersing this platinum electrode in the soil, and they are measuring this redox potential. Nowadays, a redox potential kit has been developed, in which the kit has been taken to the field and has been measuring directly, or we can collect the sample from the field and we can measure in the lab. So nowadays there are improved redox potential kit are available. By that, we can easily measure your redox potential of the soil. This redox potential will tell you whether your soil is under submerged condition or submerged or oxidized or reduced condition. And it will also tell when to irrigate or when to drain the field. Next slide, sir. So this is the redox potential kit. You can see. This is recently developed. They are calling it as a redox potential kit, in which you will have some electrode and also some of the reference electrode will be there. And it is as like similar to your pH electrode, where it is measuring pH. And it will be measuring EH. They are calling it as an EH, that is your redox potential. And you can see the working part of it in the next slide. Next slide, sir. Here, first we need to connect the electrode to the meter, and we need to change the settings to millivolt. We can measure in volt or millivolt depending upon our need of interest. And we need to rinse the electrode with the deionized water, and we need to wipe it with a cloth. And we need to press the dispenser button on the top of the electrode. Under the electrode light, jet is visible at the reference junction. Then we need to put the electrode in the sample, and then we need to measure the reading. We have seen that is 380 to 320 or something. If it is going minus, the soil is said to be under highly reduced condition. If it is under 380 to 320, it might be okay. If the soil is under some of the oxidized condition, or 150 to 180 is under partially oxidized condition, like that inference we need to give. Next slide, sir. Then coming to the causes of poor soil aeration, what will cause a soil to lack in aeration? So mostly the compact soil, some of the compaction in soil. If you take if the soil is well tilled, means the we will have some the pit in the clots has been completely plowed. So we need to reduce compaction. Otherwise, if you take the pore space of the soil, the soil air is occupied by 25% and soil water is occupied by 25%. If you are running a machinery, a machine into the field, like any tillage implement in the field, remember, you can compress soil air, but not soil water. The soil water cannot be compressed, but soil air can be compressed. So, if you are running a heavy machinery into the field, it will totally compress your soil air. That is, your 25% of your soil air pore space is completely compressed, and it will again occupied by your soil water. So, it will result in compaction of soil. So, this compaction is mainly due to the compression. Due to mainly, if you take the usage of heavy machineries or heavy vehicles while practicing some of the tillage operation in the field. And again, it will also cause some water logging problems. And the soils having excessive amount of readily decomposable organic matter also lead to poor soil aeration. And it will reduce the microbial activity, and it also results in the slow decomposition of organic matter. And rhizobium, that has the capacity to symbiotically fix atmospheric nitrogen. So microorganism is reduced. Similarly, the rhizobium microorganisms are reduced. So the rhizobium not symbiotically fix atmospheric nitrogen. Next slide. So it also results in some abnormal development of roots, as we already seen. It can happen in sugar beet and carrot. And anaerobic bacteria decompose soil organic matter in the complete absence of oxygen. And it will result in some of the toxic substances like your sulfide, which are harmful to plants. And root penetration also been a problem, because the plant roots can exert tremendous force in penetrating the soil. So the abnormal development of roots will also leads to decrease in penetration. Next slide, sir. So we need to manage soil air. Then only the plant can be grown healthierly. So how we can manage? One such way is to do tillage. So this tillage method, it breaks the soil into pet-sized conglomerate. It will create some favorable physical structure for the soil, so that it allows easier for exchange of gases. And the compaction, we need to remove the compaction so that the plots can be broken down into pets, so that there will be some good structure of the soil, so that plant roots can be penetrated into deeper into the soil, and it can absorb moisture or nutrient from the soil and can go to the plant, and the plant can grow healthier. So the management of soil air is directly dependent upon creating and maintaining this structure. Then second important thing is we need to know the selection of tillage implements. As I already mentioned, if you're running some heavy machineries, it will reduce your soil air space, and it will improve your soil water, and it will lead to more compaction in the soil. So we need to select the tillage implement depending upon the texture of the soil, and we need to go for tillage. Next slide, sir. Again, we need to avoid compaction of soil. Once the soil has been tilled, we need to avoid compaction. This is done by limiting traffic in fields or through the use of permanent beds where traffic is completely avoided. Next slide. And soil crusting. And in soil erosion itself, we have seen whenever rainfall has been hitting the ground directly, it has been damaging the soil. It will lead to surface crusting, because the rain has been flowing from a higher, whenever it is striking the ground, it is having higher velocity. So it will damage your soil particles. So the soil particles will get detached, and it can be carried, and it can be deposited in some other places. And in due course of time, it has been settled, and it will creating some massive structure. And the structure cannot be easily broken down by the root. Whenever you are planting a seed, if the soil is experiencing some crusting problems, means the root cannot penetrate, or your seedlings cannot emerge. So this is a major problem in case of surface crusting soils. So the what are the ways we can reduce surface crusting? Means we should always go for vegetation. We should not leave the land fallow, because this means the rainfall will not hit the ground directly. It will fall on the vegetation. So the soil can be protected and the erosion can be stopped. So it is one of the way we can go for management of soil crusting, or we can also go for some mulching. This mulching also reduces soil crusting. So the crusting occurs when water drops from the rainfall or overhead irrigation strike the soil surface. The energy of the water drops hitting the soil destroys the structure on the surface. Once the soil structure has been destroyed, it has been the soil has been detached and has been transported. So it will settle and it will develop a structure that has been very, very hard to break it. Then the water evaporates from the surface. It leaves an almost an impermeable crust of the soil. This crust limits the amount of gas exchange that can happen. Next slide, sir. So we need to manage the soil crusting. Either we can go for a surface cultivation, as I mentioned earlier. Cultivate the surface of soil only as deep as the crust. Either we can have some rake or hoe in small market gardens or with cultivating tines in row crops. It is just to break the crust. Using a rake or hoe, we can break the crust into small small powders. It is just like it is not completely pulverizing the soil. It is just breaking a crust only. Next slide, sir. And another way we can go for mulching. So by mulching, it just covering the soil. It will protect the soil from direct effect of rainfall. And it also having some of the indirect benefits by retaining. It also helps to retain your soil moisture. And it also avoid the weed growth of the weeds in the soil. But it also gives shade to the soil. Mulches slow down the gas exchange driven by solar radiation. But there is sufficient exchange through the other mechanism. Although we are having some mulches, means it will reduce the exchange of gases, but the gases can exchange in some other way. So it will not affect the exchange of gases. So that's all for today's class. If you have any doubt, you can ask now. So as far as the soil air is concerned, we need to remember the composition of soil air and atmospheric air. And you need to know the in what ways the movement of air, that is mass flow and diffusion. And you need to remember the Fick's law of diffusion and the measurement of soil air. That is mainly the two things, that is your ODR, that is oxygen diffusion rate. In that, you need to remember optimum ODR and the unit of ODR. And the final one is redox potential. The redox potential values in oxidized condition, how the nutrients will be in reduced condition, how the nutrients will be, and the millivolts values. These are some of the things you need to remember. And what are the causes for soil aeration, poor soil aeration, and how we can manage this soil aeration. These things you just go through, and you may expect some one or two questions in this aspect.
Okay, students, the questions are welcomed. If you have any doubts, we are here to clear. Okay, please, any doubts? If you're not interested to talk, you can put your question in the chat box. Okay, I hope there is no questions. You can leave. Thank you. This is for the class.
Thank you, sir.